Good morning. I hope we have five or six participants, as I can see from the screen. Dr. Anu Tyagi and from Muzaffarnagar are also connected. Dr. Manju Pandey, Mom Mathura Ashni are connected, I believe. Can you all hear us? Hello. So audio comes out in here. आप मेरे को वीडियो ले जाओ, अभी शेयर मत करो। अभी हाँ, काफी लोग आ गए, चार पांच लोग आ गए। सो कैन यू जस्ट टेल मी वेदर ऑडियो इज क्लियर और नॉट, सो दे कैन स्टार्ट। डॉक्टर रुचिका, एनीवन, डॉक्टर अनु त्यागी, डॉक्टर मंजू पांडे, प्लीज एनी ऑफ यू प्लीज टेल मी वेदर यू आर एबल टू हियर अस एंड सी अस। हेलो, हेलो, कुछ लोग कनेक्ट करके चले गए, कनेक्ट करके और जानते किसको उनको
कनेक्टेड है ना, सर उनसे मैं उनसे पूछ रही हूँ, उसे आवाज जा रही है। आवाज जा रही है सर,
किस पता है, कुछ वो रिस्पॉन्ड तो कोई नहीं कर रहे हैं। हाँ डॉक्टर, डॉक्टर मंजू, मैं डॉक्टर मिश्रा बोल रहा हूँ लखनऊ से। हाँ बट रेस्पॉन्ड तो करिए ना, कोई रेस्पॉन्ड नहीं कर रहा है, कैसे पता लगेगा। ठीक, अच्छा ठीक है, ठीक है, आप सुन रहे हैं। ओके, सो विल स्टार्ट एक्चुअली, सी 11 o'clock विल स्टार्ट एक्चुअली। ओके ओके, थैंक यू। सो ना एनीवे, इट्स नाउ 11:05 एंड वी शुड स्टार्ट टुडेज कोविड सीएमई सेशन, and I could see few more are getting added. It's so nice of you. So welcome you all. Today we invited Professor B.K. Paliwal from Department of Neurology to speak on neurological manifestations of COVID and how to diagnose it and how to manage it. And it's a very right time that we approached him, and in fact he has written 3 review articles on this particular aspect. I think he must have done a lot of research. And we are the lucky persons that to get his presence here and to get his knowledge to update us. So this is targeted at anybody who is taking care of the COVID patients, irrespective of the specialty, and also for general knowledge, also for all the medical professionals, so that at least we should be very careful. There may be many situations where early recognition of a complication and intervention can also have major decisions regarding the outcome. So with that introduction, I request Dr. V.K. Paliwal, Professor of Neurology Department at GPJ, to give his presentation.
Sir, Bluetooth लगा लो ना, आपको problem होगी।
Thank you, sir, for inviting me for this talk. I'm greatly honored. I was looking for an opportunity to talk on this topic because we have been working on the reviews that we wrote on this topic. So this is very upcoming. We all are overwhelmed with the COVID-19 nowadays. And so I think it is very appropriate that we talk of, especially the neurological complications in COVID-19. So when we talk of COVID-19 or for that matter for any virus that comes across, I think that human body is almost equal to, or it's a great simile between a human body and takeaway drive-through restaurants. And the reasons for simile is that here there is a very little contact with the customers, which in case of infections are viruses or bacteria. Body has to give a quick response as the restaurants have to. There are usually no permanent customers, which means that the reinfections are rare. Once the infection occurs, it is there for some time and goes off. And usually the infections are not seen, especially with many of these viruses. And how a body responds? Body has only very limited ways to respond to such infections, so it has got a limited menu. So what is the menu that body has to offer to these? So these are by which body reacts to these organisms. This could be, the mechanism could be a direct injury by the pathogen, could be secondary to autoimmunity, like we have many para and post-infectious conditions. Then there could be certain remote effects of these viruses and bacteria which the body has. So if we take COVID as example or coronavirus, the examples of direct injury to neurological structures results into hyposmia, anosmia, agusia, can cause meningitis, encephalitis. The para post-infectious conditions could be like acute disseminated encephalomyelitis or hemorrhagic necrotizing encephalitis or Guillain-Barré syndrome, which is now very hot in case of COVID-19. And there could be remote effects. They are usually the neurological effects from the involvement of systemic structures like lungs and other multi-organ dysfunctions. And this could be like encephalopathy. The other example could be critical illness.
Lastly, you have to RAPG. The
pathogens reacts, body reacts to all the pathogens almost in a similar or very similar ways. So what is so unique or special about the SARS-CoV-2? So there are certain peculiarities for this virus. So unless the other viruses like the swine flu, dengue virus, which are also prevalent in our ecosystem, SARS-CoV-2 is a respiratory virus. So there is an opportunity of very rapid spread that we have seen in past few months. Millions of people have involved. So there has been an opportunity to see a large number of neurological complications secondary to COVID in a very small span of time. Second peculiarity is that it uses ACE2 receptor for entering the human cells, especially the nerve cells. And these cells are not only on the nerves, but on various other structures and tissues like muscles, endothelial cells, and many more. So there is a little bit is also known about how the virus spreads in the human body. And third and more important thing is that even the constitutional symptoms which occur secondary to COVID-19 also has many neurological symptoms like hyposmia, myalgia, and headache. So right from the very beginning, when the virus just infects the human body, it starts producing neurological symptoms and complications. The virus is not only, coronavirus is not only different from the other viruses that we see like dengue and swine flu that I already discussed. It is also slightly different from the other beta coronaviruses. So in last two decades, we saw very large pandemics caused by beta coronavirus. The first was caused by SARS-CoV-1, which originated in Guangdong, China in 2002 and 2003. Millions of people were involved. Case fatality rate was 9.6%. The affinity of SARS-CoV-2 for ACE2 is poor. Similarly, the other was the Middle Eastern Respiratory Syndrome coronavirus, which originated in Saudi Arabia. Nearly 35%. Again, it has a very poor affinity for ACE2 receptor. So unlike these two beta coronaviruses, SARS-CoV-2, which originated in Wuhan, China in December 2019, with a very variable case fatality rate, has a very strong affinity for ACE2 receptor. So it is slightly different from the other coronaviruses also. So that is why it is worth discussing the neurological complications of coronavirus. So when we broadly classify neurological coronavirus, they can be involvement of brain and spinal cord. This could be in the form of anosmia or hyposmia. Anosmia is the loss of sensation of smell. Hyposmia is altered or reduced sensation of smell. It could be encephalitis or meningitis, encephalopathy. So certain rare causes of encephalopathy are also seen nowadays, like acute disseminated encephalomyelitis, necrotizing encephalopathy, or steroid responsive encephalopathy. Recently, strokes have also been reported in patients with COVID-19, and few cases of transverse myelitis have also been reported. If you come to the peripheral neurological system, the myalgias, myositis, and rhabdomyolysis is common. Guillain-Barré syndrome is very common, very upcoming. Similarly, it's true for Miller-Fisher syndrome. And there are certain remote effects of coronavirus in the form of critical illness, neuropathy, myopathy. Certain isolated cranial neuropathies have also been reported without the associated encephalitis and meningitis. And few patients of exacerbation of myasthenia gravis have also been reported. So there are certain very, very interesting phenomena that we have recently observed in coronavirus. So this is one of the patient who was reported in neurology, green neurology, very recently. And this is the probably the first radiological evidence that the coronavirus infects brain tissue. So if you see here, this patient who during the early part of infection on day 7, when the patient had only constitutional symptoms, especially anosmia, we see here that the olfactory bulbs, these two olfactory bulbs, are slightly hyperintense. And when they did a 3D morphometry to measure the volume, they found that they are actually swollen. And when a repeat MR was done on day 24, they found that this altered signal came back to the normal, and it also reduced in size. So this was probably the first radiological evidence that the olfactory dysfunction in coronavirus, unlike other viruses, is not simply because of a common cold. It is probably because of the involvement of olfactory bulbs. It is involving the central pathways of smell. It is not only in the acute stage, but in the convalescent phase also. Like here, this patient who had by chance had a previous imaging where the olfactory bulbs were found to be normal. And in the follow-up, after a few weeks of recovery from coronavirus, they found that actually there was axonal damage in the olfactory bulb, and actually bulbs reduced in size. You can see the CSF spaces have enlarged secondary to atrophy of the olfactory bulb. So these are the unambiguous kind of evidences that shows, radiological evidence that shows that the coronavirus actually has a propensity to invade and directly infect the brain tissue. So what are the olfactory dysfunctions seen in COVID-19? There is a strong evidence today that the olfactory dysfunction is an early manifestation of COVID-19. It is one of the constitutional symptoms other than fever, cough, sore throat, and headache. Among the olfactory symptoms, anosmia is the most common symptom. Other are hyposmia, ageusia, and dysgeusia. Ageusia is loss of taste. Dysgeusia is altered taste. Those patients who did not complain of olfactory symptoms, when they examined by the test of smell, they were all found to have olfactory dysfunction. So if we see the proportion of patients, nearly 80% of the patients who have coronavirus may have olfactory dysfunction after testing. And when they tested these patients and correlated these, they found that the olfactory dysfunction was not related to the severity of disease, but it was related to the duration of the constitutional symptoms. And regarding the natural history of anosmia, they found that nearly 50% of the patients show improvement in anosmia by second week of illness. So this was again a very, very important evidence that the coronavirus infects brain tissue. It was a neuroendoscopically driven olfactory neuroepithelium And here it was the immunofluorescence staining of CD68. These are green colored cells, which are depicted by white arrows. And we can see that the CD68 macrophages are seen both in the epithelium as well as in the stroma. And when they double stained these macrophages for both CD68 macrophages as well as for SARS-CoV-2 nucleoproteins, they found that these macrophages were containing these SARS-CoV-2 nucleoproteins, which is again a very strong evidence that the virus infects olfactory neuroepithelium and it has a potential to cause direct infection of the brain tissue. So the other important complications secondary to coronavirus, neurological complications involving brain, are encephalitis and encephalopathy. We use the term encephalitis when we have evidence of SARS-CoV-2 in the CSF. So if the CSF is inflammatory and if there is RT-PCR for coronavirus positive in the CSF, we call it encephalitis. And if there is a diffuse brain dysfunction due to any cause in a patient with COVID-19, and if the CSF is normal, then we call it as encephalopathy. This was one of the studies where 113 deceased patients of coronavirus were evaluated retrospectively. And they found that all those who had dyspnea and chest discomfort, if they had encephalopathy, the rate of death was 22% as compared to without encephalopathy. So the presence of encephalopathy was a kind of a predictor for poor outcome or mortality in patients with COVID-19. And the cause of encephalopathy that they studied was ARDS, sepsis, acute myocardial injury, cardiac failure, electrolyte abnormalities, renal failure, and other systemic abnormalities. This is another study which was the only study which collected patients prospectively. There were 1150 lab confirmed cases of COVID-19. Out of them, they found 257, around 22% were critically ill. And out of these 257, 82% patients had comorbid illnesses. Nearly 80% required mechanical ventilation. And out of these 257 critically ill patients, 9% patients had altered mental status. So if we have some evidence of prevalence of encephalopathy in patients with COVID-19, it is around 10%. But this is the only single study which has evaluated patients prospectively. We wrote a review on neurological manifestations, and we collected 42 records of 56 isolated cases of encephalopathy and encephalitis. What we found was that the patient who were encephalopathic had an older age, more than 50 years. Most of them belong to urban background. The preceding duration of illness before they develop encephalopathy ranged from 5 days to 14 days. The initial constitutional symptoms are fever, cough, dyspnea, anosmia, and agiusia. Before developing altered consciousness, they had headache and vomiting. Blood parameters, majority showed lymphopenia and thrombocytopenia. They had evidence of cytokine storm in the form of elevated acute phase reactants. Pneumonia, COVID pneumonia was present, or other lung manifestations are present in almost all of these patients. CSF was inflammatory only in few. Neuroimaging in majority of patients revealed periventricular ischemic changes. The diagnosis in these patients were obtained by the neuroropharyngeal swab test, RT-PCR, and many patients required ICU care. Either the patient died or recovered, and the sequelae was none in these 56 cases. So this was a very interesting observation. Though the patient number was only 3, but it was suggestive of very important things. This was myoclonus in patients who were having COVID-19 encephalopathy. There were 3 cases. All of them had hypersomnolence or excessive sleepiness. All of them had a stimulus-sensitive myoclonus. They had normal neurological examination, normal CSF, EEG, and MRI. All 3 patients had COVID pneumonia, and they improved with methylprednisolone. Now, the important aspect of this was that the myoclonus, stimulus-sensitive myoclonus in encephalopathy is usually seen in autoimmune encephalitis, which is a recently upcoming entity. So people now are saying that the COVID-19 has a potential to produce a para-infectious autoimmune encephalitis, and this could be one of the pointers towards it. We also studied the neuroimaging abnormalities in all the patients who had encephalopathy. So the abnormalities were T2 flare changes in cortical, subcortical white matter. There were white matter signal changes with microbleeds. There were symmetrical bilateral hemorrhagic thalamic lesions. There were posterior reversible encephalopathy syndrome as seen in autoimmune encephalitis. There were multifocal white matter hyperintensities as seen in ADM. There were periventricular T2 flare hyperintensities, which was one of the most common MRI abnormalities in patients with encephalopathy. And then there were leptomeningeal enhancement. How the virus actually produced encephalopathy and encephalitis? For encephalopathy, the most underlying feature was cytokine storm, sepsis and shock, which resulted from and resulted into ARDS, multi-organ dysfunction, coagulopathy and circulatory failure. It led to the hypoxia and metabolic dysfunction. There was tissue hypoxia, which resulted eventually into infarcts and multiple punctate hemorrhages, and eventually led into the diffuse brain dysfunction, which manifested in the form of delirium, stupor, and coma. How the virus caused encephalitis? So there is an evidence now, as we have discussed previously, that SARS-CoV-2 used its spike protein, which is a part of its Greg glycoprotein envelope, and binds to ACE2 receptor, which is widely expressed on olfactory epithelium. This is now believed as one of the main pathways of entering of COVID-19 virus into the human brain. The other method was that it circumvents blood-brain barrier by attaching to endothelium, vascular endothelium, doesn't have to go through the blood and pass the blood-brain barrier, but can directly go through the vessel wall and infect the brain tissue. Then it can also has a retrograde axonal transport of SARS-CoV-2 from the liver and gut. So these are some of the postulated mechanisms by which the virus enters into the brain tissue and may produce encephalitis. So these are the rare case causes of encephalopathy. The middle one is the acute necrotizing encephalitis, which is very common to all viruses that produce CNS infections. It produces hemorrhagic, the necrotizing encephalopathy, especially involving bilateral thalami. You see here that the flare shows swollen thalami with hyperintensities. Diffusion shows diffusion restriction, and there is no hemorrhage on the gradient recall images. In hemorrhagic leukoencephalitis, there are widespread white matter changes along with multiple microbleeds. And in ADM, there are bilateral white matter hyperintensities. All these patients present with altered consciousness. Some of them present with status epilepticus, which is also not an uncommon manifestation of COVID-19 encephalopathy. Recently, there have been report of stroke in patients with COVID-19. So this is one of the report where the prospectively patients were collected and evaluated. All the number of patients were small in this series, but it was significant because they belong to a comprehensive stroke center, and all the patients were prospectively collected. The 13 patients, 31 to 80 years. Now the majority of stroke were large vessel stroke in COVID-19. Cause of which could not be determined, so it is referred to as embolic stroke of unknown origin. There was a trend of less use of thrombolysis in COVID-19 related stroke, and probable reason was because of COVID-19 related coagulopathy and endothelial dysfunction. There have been recent reports of transverse myelitis. We collected and identified 13 cases. The paper is still is communicated, but has not been accepted. We found that 6 patients had age more than 60 years. 6 patients had pre-existing comorbidities. 8 patients had pneumonia. 7 patients had paraplegia. Rest had quadriparesis. 7 patients presented with longitudinally extensive transverse myelitis. Only 1 patient had infective myelitis. That is, the RT-PCR was positive in CSF for SARS-CoV-2. Majority of these patients, like the other causes of transverse myelitis, responded to pulse steroids, IVIG or plasmapheresis. And when we evaluated the etiology, we found that majority of transverse myelitis were part of ADEM. And rest single cases were that of a hypoxic myelitis, MOG antibody related myelitis and necrotizing myelitis. Now we come on to the peripheral neurological manifestation COVID-19. And myalgia is one of the very important neurological manifestations. It is seen nearly half of the patients who have COVID-19, one of the constitutional symptoms. The more common constitutional symptoms are fever, cough, expectoration, dyspnea, and anosmia. Anosmia, as I said previously, may be seen in up to 70-75% of patients. Myalgias are more common in elderly. In one of the studies, they studied what are the independent predictors of unimprovement, and they found that the muscle aches, especially in elderly, was one of the independent predictor. The other predictors are male, being male, severe COVID-19 condition, expectoration, and low albumin at admission. They found that myalgia not only is a constitutional symptom, but it persists even in the late stage of the disease, even after convalescence. That is, in this particular study, they found that the median time of 23 days of cessation of viral shedding, the myalgia was still persistent. So myalgia could be a long-standing problem in patients with COVID-19. So whether the myalgia is in continuum with myositis and rhabdomyolysis is still not known. But there are increasingly the presentation of reports of myositis and rhabdomyolysis. In our review, we identified 9 patients with COVID-19-related myositis and rhabdomyolysis. 8 presented either with generalized or focal limb weakness, 4 had myalgias. All of these patients had elevated CPK levels. One patient had actually cola-colored urine and his CK level was in several of thousands. Other had microscopic hematuria. 6 patients had lung abnormalities. 2 patients required mechanical ventilation. And 5 of these patients actually improved. And rest of them were either improving or were on mechanical ventilation at the time of writing of their reports. So how the virus produces muscle injury? Again, there are many speculations about this. And the most widely accepted is the expression of ACE2 on myocytes and other muscle cells. And they think that the SARS-CoV-2 actually directly attaches to the ACE2 and results into direct muscle injury. The other mechanisms could be mechanism of molecular mimicry, where there is a similarity or homology between the viral antigen and the muscle antigen. Then there could be immune complexes which get deposited into the muscle and they release myotoxic cytokines. And the other pathophysiology could be adsorption of viral proteins on muscle surface. They express on muscle surface and the injury that is produced as a the innocent bystander mechanism. So all these mechanisms could be responsible for muscle injury resulting into myositis and rhabdomyolysis. Recently, there have been a large number of reports. They are almost coming on the daily basis of Guillain-Barré syndrome in patients with COVID-19. So we identified 39 patients in our review. The age range was 21 to 85 years. Majority were of more than 50 years. I'm sorry for this technical glitch. So we were discussing GB syndrome in patients with COVID-19. So I was discussing that the majority of the patient had demyelinating type of neuropathy. And nearly 1/3 of the patient with GB syndrome did not have a good outcome. They had a poor outcome. Similarly, the one of the variant of GB syndrome is Miller-Fisher variant. We identified 5 cases. The age range was 36 to 74 years. 3 were males. All had preceding URTI or diarrhea. 3 had gait difficulty, ataxia, and areflexia, which is usually the triad of Miller-Fisher syndrome. 2 patients had ophthalmoparesis and 1 had visual blurring. 4 patients received IVIG and all the 5 patients improved. When we compared, compared the COVID-19 related GBS versus the typical GBS, GBS secondary to Zika virus and GBS secondary to dengue virus. What we found was there were certain unique features of GBS secondary to the coronavirus. It was, first one was that unlike the other typical GBS which occurs in young patients, the COVID-19 related GBS occurred in elderly. Ajusia and hyposmia were the unique features of COVID-19 infection which are not seen in typical GBS and GBS secondary to other viruses. The respiratory failure was one of the very prominent features in patients with GBS related to coronavirus, which is not that common in other the typical GBS. Most patients with COVID-19 actually receive hydroxychloroquine, antiviral drugs and IVIG unlike the other GB syndromes. And more than half of the patient had poor outcome in the form of either long ICU stay, residual paresis, or residual dysphagia. So how the virus produced GB syndrome is not clear, because the most common mechanism that is widely accepted for the GB syndrome is molecular mimicry, that is post-infectious. But unlike the typical GB syndrome, where the molecular mimicry is thought to be the important mechanism, in COVID-19, the GB syndrome was para-infectious. Para-infectious means during the active illness, the GB syndrome occurred in these patients. So the postulated mechanism is direct toxic cytotoxic effect of virus on nerves. The molecular mimicry is because of the shared epitopes between the coronavirus and the nerve cells. And this is again a very important discovery that the COVID-19 shares 2 hexapeptides with human shock proteins 90 and 60. And both these proteins are listed among the 42 other proteins which are immunogenic for causation of both GB syndrome and chronic inflammatory demyelinating polyneuropathy. And these epitopes could be possibly responsible for the mechanism of molecular mimicry in patients with COVID-19 related post-infectious GB syndrome. So the isolated cranial neuropathies have also been reported in patients with coronavirus. This was a 36-year-old male who had constitutional symptoms, diplopia, secondary to left third nerve palsy and bilateral sixth nerve palsy. MRI showed enhancement of the left third nerve and he showed complete improvement with IVIG. Another 71-year-old female presented with painless right sixth cranial nerve palsy with enhancement of left optic nerve sheath. Again, she improved. Another 69-year-old male presented with left fourth nerve palsy. He had evidence of vertebrobacillar vasculitis. And he also showed improvement with intravenous methylprednisolone. Other cranial neuropathies reported are infranuclear facial palsy, glossopharyngeal nerve palsy, vagus nerve palsy, and trigeminal palsy. Trigeminal nerve palsy was seen in association with the herpes zoster virus in a patient with COVID-19. Most of these patients improved with immunotherapy or spontaneously. All of them had lung abnormalities on chest imaging, which is very common in patients with COVID-19. So there have been other reports of myasthenia gravis aggravation, which I have not included because we don't know whether it's a remote effect of coronavirus or is a direct effect of coronavirus on neuromuscular junction. And most of these patients, there are 6-7 patients who have been reported till date of myasthenia gravis. And most of these patients improved on IVIG or continuation of continuation of steroids. In 3 of these patients, their immunomodulator drugs were transiently stopped during the active infection. They were azathioprine and mycophenolate mofetil, which was later started after recovery from the coronavirus. So to summarize, SARS-CoV-2 has a special affinity for neural tissue. The olfactory and gustatory symptoms are accepted as early manifestation of COVID-19 infection. Now we have unambiguous evidence that is olfactory bulb inflammation and edema with axonal damage secondary to COVID-19. And now this is accepted as one of the route entry for virus into the brain that later on produces encephalitis and other cranial neuropathies. Among peripheral nervous system, myalgia is one of the common early symptoms of the disease. GB syndrome and Miller-Fisher variant of GB syndrome are increasingly being described in patients with concomitant COVID infection. The peripheral neuropathy occurs either because of the direct infection of nerves by virus or by the mechanism of molecular mimicry. Now we have some evidence in support of molecular mimicry in case of COVID-19 related GBS. There are also reports of myositis and rhabdomyosis secondary to COVID-19. And probably it is the ACE2 receptor that widely expresses on the surface of muscles, which is postulated to have a role in SARS-CoV-2 related myositis. So thank you so much.
You can ask if they have any
questions. Do you have any questions, please?
Hello.
Yes, hello.
Hello, good morning. Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
Sir, as a very nice presentation, and we came to know so much new things. Sir, just myositis, myalgia is it's a first symptoms before any fever and all that. Sometimes it's noticed like that.
Yes, exactly. So myositis could be a very early feature of COVID infection. And what we are seeing in real time here is that even before the development of fever, patients start having a feeling of fatigue and muscle pain aches. And after 3 or 4 days of having fever and myalgia, they start having fever. So that is why it is very interesting that the neurological manifestation could be very early in the COVID-19 infection. So you're absolutely...
Yes, sir. Like as anosmia and the loss of taste.
Yes, exactly.
Sir, this myositis, your myalgia is more common in which part of muscles? Lower limb, upper limb?
Yes.
So, yeah, all over.
Generally, as I said, the myalgia could be generalized, but there is a general rule that more bulkier the muscle is, that is more commonly involved with muscle, the muscle aches and pains. So you'll find that the gluteal and the thigh region are more commonly affected, but it could be generalized.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Okay. Any other
sir, just one more question. Sir, the axonal damage is, as you said, after treatment, it become recover after 3 weeks, 2 to 3 weeks. Then this olfaction functions normally and that. So this is recover.
So the natural history that has been like delineated till date is that nearly 50% of patients may recover by second week. But we also have radiological evidence that there could be permanent changes in the olfactory bulb. So patient might say that the functions have recovered, but if you test the patient, we might find certain abnormalities still in the olfactory functions of a patient. So we still don't know, but there could be some residual problems with olfaction in patients, in at least some patients with COVID-19.
Okay. Some residual effects will be there.
Yeah, maybe. They may be there. Yes.
Yes. Okay. Thank you very much, sir.
Most welcome. Any other question, please?
Dr. Mayank in chat has a question.
So Dr. Mayank has asked that does olfactory bulb atrophy recover? So that I already answered that we don't know. But as we have seen that many patients who did not complain of olfactory dysfunction or who did not have any symptoms of anosmia and hyposmia, when they examined, they had abnormalities in olfaction. So even after the recovery of anosmia, some people might have certain olfactory dysfunction if they are examined. So, but we have evidence that the axonal damage may be there in olfactory burn. Patient might have recovered, but they still might show certain abnormalities if they are examined. Thank you. So thank you all for very patient listening. If you have any question, you can just mail it to me. Can we provide my email ID to them?
Yes, sir. You can just write on the chat.
So I can hear you write. So I am writing my email ID to you.
So. Good morning, sir. I have a question. Can I ask?
Yes, please.
Yeah. So, have you in your, you have a lot of data. Have you seen these neurological complications in plastic age group also, sir? Because we are patient. Yes, I just need to know. I just wanted to know that these neurological complications in your experience, have you seen in pediatric age group also, sir?
See, we personally have not witnessed many neurological complications. We had certain pediatric patients who presented with the stroke, both ischemic as well as hemorrhagic.
Okay,
and
sir.
They had COVID-19 and they were admitted to a triage area from which they were shifted to ICU and one child died. We also had patients who had aneurysmal bleeds and had COVID-19. So we still don't know whether it was related to COVID-19 or not.
Or it was a coincidence, we'll find.
Yes, it was a coincidence.
Okay, thank you, sir.
These are the children that I can recollect, whom I saw when I was posted in COVID for my COVID duties.
Okay.
Ye communicate ho gaya? So I have communicated my email ID to all of you. So kindly, if you have any question, just please mail me. And I'll be very happy to reply. Thank you so much. Thank you so much to all of you.